is about introduction to electric vehicles. We will get you introduced to the vehicles shortly now. And our speaker for the session is going to be Ms. Rekha Sharma. Rekha is an experienced professional with over 12 years of experience in leading teams and projects in development, budgeting, testing, and support of SaaS projects in the North American market. She is also the co-founder of a company called SolferX, which is based out of Canada and provides consultation to utilities, grid operators for technology and strategic initiatives, like investigation of operational issues and recommendations to achieve grid reliability, developing data models for EV charging schedules to optimize the price and peak load conditions, automation and development of a test bed for various grid operation tools. So prior to this, she was the technology manager at California ISO, which is based in the US, for managing operations for the wholesale electricity market. She has also worked with electrical majors like ABB and Siemens in the past, and has a master's degree in electrical from Texas A&M University in the US, and a bachelor's university from the Delhi College of Engineering. So on that note, I would now like to invite Ms. Rekha Sharma to take us through the session on introduction to electric vehicles. Over to you, Rekha.
Hello, everyone, and thank you, Dhruv, for the introduction. I will share my slides now. Just a sec. Give me a minute. Or maybe do you guys want to share, Dhruv?
Sure.
Dhruv, can you share?
Yeah. Sure, sure. Gaurav, can you share the slides? We'll run them.
Yeah, sharing. Just sharing.
So meanwhile, till the time Gaurav sets up the slide, there are maybe one or two lines that I wanted to add. So the things that she has been working on in the US and the Canadian market are things which are more related to subjects of future, especially as far as the Indian market is concerned. We haven't seen so far a lot of activity in areas like, you know, charging schedules, price performance optimization, peak load conditions, so far to an extent in the distribution market in India. So these are kind of subjects for the future. And the reason why I'm mentioning here is for students who are looking to, you know, build careers in this space, these are subjects into which, you know, expertise will be required going on in the future years. So, you know, from that perspective, it's a very different, it's a very interesting subject. Ready, Gaurav?
Yeah, ready. Sharing.
Thank you, Gaurav, and I'll keep prompting you when I request you to change the slide so we can coordinate like that. Okay, so next slide, please. Gaurav, next slide, please. Yes. So hello, everyone. I'm Rekha Sharma, as Dhruv introduced me, and I will be introducing the electrical vehicles from the design policy perspective. So these are the agenda for today for my session. Just understanding what is the basis of electricity vehicle and how is it related to climate change? Why everyone is just, you know, encouraging that and trying to introduce this, how is it going to help us? Just a broad picture. Then a little bit on policy landscape in India for EVs and basis of electric vehicles, key components of EVs, and especially I've been told that you all are students, so I would say this basis of EV and the key components would really excite you. And then the lastly, we'll close the chapter by the current market outlook. Next slide, please. Next. Okay. So here is India's climate commitment. So India ratified the Paris Agreement exactly 1 year after the submission of its intended nationally determined contribution in 2016. They had three goals. One goal was to reduce the emission intensity. Second, to increase the share of the non-fossil based energy resources to 40%. And lastly, to create additional carbon sink. Carbon sink is nothing but you're going to grow some trees, right? Next slide, please. Next. Yeah. So, as you know, India is quite polluted and populated country as we compare it to the world. 14 of 15 most polluted cities of the world are in India. Just in Delhi, the 36% of NOx emission is due to vehicles, right? And 25% of PM emission in Delhi is due to vehicles. So I'm emphasizing on these numbers because I want you to get a feel of it, that in last 10 or 20 years in the whole world, the solar and the wind power plants were, you know, there was a fact. Because we said that the electricity which is generated by coal or natural gas is not green, so we should go green. But that's just maybe 20 or 30% of the power. But as you see, this number is for Delhi, but I'm sure wherever you're living, the number would map around 30% of all the emissions would be from the scooters and for the cars that you guys are running. So just making it relatable that if we get that out, the carbon emission and the GHG emission will significantly reduce, and the global warming that we are seeing and everyone is trying to go green will be a success just by going the power plants from coal to solar or wind is just part of the picture. The other part is vehicle, and that's why everyone is now after that. Okay, next slide, please. Next. Okay. So why e-vehicles? We know vehicles are a problem, but do we know that EV can be an answer? Here are some facts. And if these slides are, you know, shared with you after the session, this is a good note for you guys. The transport sectors account for 18% of total energy consumption in India. Electric mobility is a clean alternative to our conventional fuel-powered vehicles. Okay. The increased adoption of e-vehicle can lead to significant reduction in GHG emissions. So what is GHG? GHG is greenhouse gas emission. Green, if you have more greenhouse gas emission, they pollute the environment such that it has a greenhouse effect. Means all the heat is trapped in the atmosphere. And that's what is probably causing the global warming. So if we can get rid of the GHG gases, the hope is that the global warming might stop, or at least can be controlled. Electric vehicles, once integrated with the renewable energy system, it can go to the net zero transport system. So this net zero, I'm sure you must have heard of the net zero term. Basically, imagine a power which is generated by solar or wind, and then you charge your vehicle by that power. So there is no emission to generate that electricity, and then there is no emission to drive that car or a scooter or a two-wheeler or an auto. Then that's where the world wants to go, and we're calling it net zero. The deteriorating air quality in cities with high traffic, like Hyderabad, Delhi, or Mumbai, that can be, you know, significantly improved by EVs. Next, please. Next. Yeah. So our second topic is policy landscape in India for EVs. So let's get into the details. So I think this slide was also covered by my previous speaker, Pradeep sir, because it is so important. We want to see what all our country is doing. You must have heard of the FAME 1 and the FAME 2. The FAME 1 itself was around 900 crore. That's a massive amount of money just for, you know, driving this incentive. Again, after just 4 years, government is, you know, ready to share 10,000 crore again. So that tells where our country wants to go. Our country is already, like, India is around fourth largest producer of renewable energy. And now with this kind of effort from government, we see that by 2030, 40% vehicles will be electric. And 40% of some other country, let's say Netherlands or Ireland, is different than 40% of India. That's like three, four countries of that size put together. So that's a massive step. That's like millions and millions of vehicles will be electric. So it's a great effort, just to give you the intensity. Next. Again, probably one more slide where I want to re-emphasize how much our government is trying to push. I want to highlight in this slide that what in FAME II the amendments were. We know that the EV can be cars or the buses or the trucks, but where we see for India, the potential is in the two-wheelers and the three-wheelers and the buses. Because of our nature of the you know, transportation system, what is mostly used, the two-wheelers and the three-wheelers and the buses are going to have the maximum impact. If I have to pick between the cars and the two-wheeler, probably I'll pick two-wheelers, because more number of people will have two-wheelers and more number of people use it on day-to-day basis. So that's significant. And we see that the bus use of these big cities like Delhi and Mumbai or Hyderabad, if we invest there, that's again a great, great success. Okay, next. Yeah, you can go next. Next. Yeah, so this again, let's look into this and zoom in, like how we are doing. This chart is for two-wheelers, the FAME and the non-FAME, how many two-wheelers we had in our country. As you can see, in 2016 and 17, we had around 20,000, not much, but it was on rise. We see a massive increase after 2019. 2019 and 20 numbers look promising. And if if we go by this speed, we'll definitely reach our net zero goal of 2030, like 40% of the EVs. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, here let's zoom in. And I've been told that most of you are in Hyderabad or in Vizag, look at the South India chart. Let me describe the chart a little bit and then we'll go by region, the region that you're interested in. So this is basically regional scales of electric three-wheelers through FAME 1 and FAME 2 incentives. So the red one is FAME 1 and the blue bar is FAME 2. So if you see for the whole India, we see that the FAME 1 was successful, but FAME 2 is like really, like it is, it's like almost double successful as FAME 1 was. One thing to note is, look at the South India. I see that FAME 1, this is the only region where FAME 1 has so far, outperformed FAME 2. What do you mean by that? You can infer that, people are aware and people are proactive, and FAME 1 itself is quite successful. And if we just go maybe 2 or 3 more years, we will see that FAME 2 will will out success in the film one. But that's a very good thing. And I know which region you guys are coming from. This is a very good news. And now that you are participating in this workshop, and I'm sure similar workshops, the people more aware, they will adopt this technology, and the more number of people buying these two-wheelers or three-wheelers or cars, this will be a success in no time. Next. Next slide, please. Okay. So let's just spend some time on this, these numbers, just, for some encouragement. In Andhra Pradesh, we see that the target by 2024 is around 1 million EVs. Yeah. And government is going to provide reimbursement of road tax and registration fees. So if anyone wants to buy something, that's an incentive right there for you. Now government is planning to replace the public transport buses in four cities to e-buses by 2024 and across the state by 2030. So in just next 8 years, most of the buses which you'll see on the roads would be EV. Establish 1 lakh slow and fast charging station by 2024. And of course, we're going to celebrate Green Race. Now let's zoom in into Telangana. Target for 2025 to achieve 80% two-wheelers and three-wheelers, 70% commercial cars, 40% buses, 30% private cars, and 15% electrification of all vehicles by 2025. So that is coming in less than a decade, so just 4 years to go. That's the target. Good news for us, professional, me and you, is it's going to create some 20,000 workers, jobs for us by 2025 through EVs and the shared mobility, charging infrastructure development, and EV manufacturing activities. Attract worth of $3 billion and support for charging infrastructure development. So this is good information for focusing on your area. Okay. Next, please. You can skip this. Next. Next. Okay, so let's just zoom in into by how, our these laws and energy efficiency standards, they are helping. I did skip the previous two slides, but I'm going to summarize all of that in this. There are lots of building models, the codes which are coming in the infrastructure that we see. And all these places that you're seeing, the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, Energy Conservation Building Code, and Econivas, Samhita in 2018, all these are your keywords. All these people are working towards, they might be architectural coding department, but they have this green goal incentive, and that can be your keyword too if you want to find a job somewhere. Next slide, please. Okay, now let's get into the topic. I feel that if most of you are engineers or you're trying to find a career in EVs, these are the basics I would say everyone should have. So let's look into an electric car. Let's open up an electric car and see how it will look. First and foremost, everyone knows that it doesn't go, you don't have to go to petrol pump or put in petrol. It's a charging plug. Just how you charge your phone, you're going to have a charging plug for your car. Okay, so in this picture on your right, I've just zoomed in on 3-4 things that everyone should know. If you're driving an EV, how does it look like? It has a big battery pack, it has built-in charger, and it has a motor. Okay. It has electric vehicles are powered by electric motor. There is no rotor or combustion engine like how we used to have in our olden combustion engine cars. Just to give you the simplicity of a design or the beauty of the design of EV, the traditional powertrains have as many as 2,000 electromagnetic parts. But our EVs, they have only 20 components. So, you know, it makes the design quite, I would say, intriguing how that combustion engine car is able to do that in more complicated way and how simplistic it has become with EVs. Then in conventional vehicles, we needed care to keep the engine within the narrow range of engine speed to optimize the torque and the power as the vehicle accelerate. But in EV, we have a single speed transmission, okay, as they are efficient across a broad range of RPMs, the rotational torque. Okay, so for ACs, for air conditioning, conventional vehicles use belts connected to the engine to rotate the AC compressor. But in EVs, electric driven compressors are used. Controllers and inverters, boards are employed to allow power the AC from the battery power. So straight from the battery, you're gonna run the AC, okay? Next. So just a little bit of history and so that you know how the EV has evolved. In last 4 or 5 years, you must be hearing this word a lot, but this is not as recent. We've had electric cars centuries back, like 2 centuries back. But from my personal research, if I say that the first successful EV automaker was GM in early 90s, the time was different, the wave was different. So it was a strategic move for GM to not go ahead with that, which could be a good strategy or bad. We can debate about it. But the first pure EV, which was successful, was Toyota Prius, but it was a hybrid car, right? After that, what came in the news mostly was Tesla. In 2008, that's the first pure EV, which was commercially successful. Then we have had Nissan Leaf. Then in India, we have Mahindra, which is immensely successful, affordable, and functional. We have big giga factories coming up, and now there are multiple manufacturers. So just to tell you that it's not a recent phenomenon, it's just that time is right, everyone is aware, and everyone is accepting it now. And that's why it is becoming so popular. Next. Let's zoom into our manufacturers in India. India has actually the most variety of vehicles. We have cars, two-wheelers, three-wheelers, rickshaws, buses, and trucks. And you can see, like, I've just put in the logos over there, but you can see for electric cars, the Tata and the Mahindra are the leaders. For two-wheelers, the Bajaj and Ather and Hydroelectric, Hero Electric, there are many, many manufacturers. For three-wheelers, we have Mahindra and Bajaj. For rickshaws, we have Sarathi and Jiva. For the buses, the Tata is leading. And for electric trucks, again, Tata and the Ashok Legend are leading. But this, I just put it out there that it's not just one, like, you know, you must have heard Tesla, but it's not one. Like, especially in our India, we have so many players and so many different types of vehicles are available. And they're all as good for an energy professional. If I am making policies for global warming, for me, I don't differentiate between a two-wheeler or a bus. It's just emission, which is the point of focus in our efforts. Next. Okay, so this is more like mechanical engineer and electrical engineer should be like really, really focused on here, where we're dissecting different types of electric vehicles. As I said, the Prius was really commercially successful car, but it was a hybrid car. Now, what do you mean by hybrid? Don't we have an electric motor? Yes, but it also has a gasoline engine. So the way hybrid or if you imagine Prius works is we're going to have a gasoline engine, we're going to have an electric motor. If you look into the leftmost picture, you'll see that the battery power is charged by the gasoline engine, you know, according to the design. But then the another version of it is when you have plug-in hybrid. So you have electric motor and battery and you're charging it from your plug, but there is a gasoline engine kind of in a parallel. So if this doesn't work, that works, right? And you, it's scheduled. But what we're really after now is this battery electric vehicle. So when we say EV, this is what we're after, where we just have electric motor and we have a battery pack. And all I'm doing is running my car with this electric motor. I don't have a gasoline engine at all. I'm going to charge my battery from the plug and like whenever it's discharged, and I'm going to run it on this electric motor. And that's what the success means for us for EV. While the technology was available in the hybrid and the plug-in hybrid, like which was almost similar, but we can run a car with the acceptable range, with the acceptable pickup, and good performance with this battery electric vehicle. That's what we want to achieve as EV professionals. Next, please. Okay, good. So thank you for the GT team for a good, a video. But, you know, whatever I'm speaking, it was very well summarized there, how we don't have gears, how there is no carbon dioxide emission, there is no smoke coming from EV, it's very silent, it picks up fast, everything. That video is very good summary of that. Now let's open up the car a little bit more. Initially, I just showed you big things, right? The battery pack and the motor and how you charge it. But here you see a little bit more detail. So let's start from A. So we have that pack that I showed you before. Then we have this charging port written J over there. Then we have the transmission. This is like similar transmission that you have in the EV. And you have the onboard charging, batteries, thermal system, because every battery will heat up. You need a thermal cooling system. You have a DC to DC converter where you're gonna have, means I won't go too much in detail, but I would like to say that the battery that I need in the car is DC. The power which comes in my house is AC. So either my car is going to take the AC power, convert it to DC, and then it's going to use it. Or there are some DC chargers out there, like fast chargers, that they're going to convert the AC to DC within them, and they're going to give the DC charge to my car. And that's what this DC to DC converter is. It's just a change in the voltage level. That's it. It's just step up and step down. Then you have the controllers and inverter. This is used when you are plugging in straight from your house, where you're taking the electricity and that you need to, you know, invert the power, then you have the traction motors. So not complicating this, you know, this session too much, but I just wanted to introduce that there are, you know, enough parts, and it's quite intelligent. This whole BMS, we call it battery management system, is quite intricate. It is designed for AC power input. It is designed for DC power input. It can take care that whatever, you know, level you give in, it can boost it up or down. And it has very sophisticated cooling system, and the battery battery design is such that it is designed in the bottom of the car, which makes the car more stable. So it makes the car a little heavy right now, but there is a lot of research going on which will make it lighter, hopefully in future. But let's say a Tesla, if it's a sedan, and you see another sedan, let's say a Civic or a Corolla, Tesla would be a little heavier because of the battery weight, but its weight is mostly focused on the bottom, which also makes it very stable. Next slide, please. Okay, so I think I did give you a little bit snippet of the charging in my previous slide, but here is the detailed you know, version. As I said, there is AC to DC charging. It's just your house has AC. I'm gonna plug it in my car, and within my car, I can convert it and take the DC power. You have DC chargers too. It's not in the slide, but you have AC DC charging, DC DC charging. And one thing which I really appreciate India for is this battery swapping. I've not seen it in many parts of the world, but India is one of the leading players in the battery swapping, where you just don't waste your time charging the car. You just go to the battery swap station, and you just gonna you know, take the battery out of your vehicle, or it's really popular in the two wheelers, and go to the charging station, dock it there, get another one, and you're off you go. It's just a 5-minute thing. So most of the people complain about the charging time it's going to take, or about the pickup, which is not there anymore, like after Tesla. But this battery swapping is a game changer. It's just a 5-minute thing, no time waste, and it works as good. The next thing is induction charger. So this is a non-contact method, and you just park your car on top, and it just charges itself. Personally, I've never used it, but that's the futuristic goal. Like, imagine if your car is autonomous driving, it can just come and charge on top of this, and then it can drive itself, and it can drive it back. So it's very futuristic design, and I'm sure it's there somewhere in the world, but like, personally, I haven't seen it, but this is going to be probably the future. Okay, next. Okay, so the key components of EV value chain. Not sure how much you would be interested, but this is like the whole world. It's like the Bible of, or a Gita of, our EV business. We're going to have automated players where we can see who's manufacturing the batteries, the cars, you know, all the motors, all the parts of the cars, and then whoever is on the sales side. And then in the market side, like, you know, if you have a EV, it's gonna, of course, will need a repair or some replacement. So this is the whole proposition of like what all jobs you might have, or what all careers might come from this effort of EVs. Now, in the electrification side, you have a massive effort of charging station infrastructure coming. So you're going to have a supply and demand on that. You're going to have people designing it and installing it and commissioning those. So that itself is a field in itself. Then for a charging station, you have operations and service of the charging station. That's a field in itself. And then service support for the station. That's again a job proposition. And on the IoT, Internet of Things services, I see that they can do predictive models, and then the fleet management tools, and the infrastructure like charging information, and some analytics over there. So then again, we have, you know, a lot of job opportunities if you are more on the analytics side. So this is like the whole, I would say, Bible of EV job proposition for us, okay, for us professionals. Next slide, please. Okay, I would skip it for now. Skip. Next. Yeah. So, yes, let's just stick to this. So this is all of us stakeholder. I think in the previous picture, I showed you what all jobs we gonna have, but here what are our players, right? So that you have some names in your brain when you are out of this workshop. Who are the players? How predominant they are in their own efforts? So for the EV manufacturer, especially for the four wheelers and the buses, as I said, Tata Motor is a leader. We have Goldstone, Ashok Legend, and Ather Energy. For fleet operation, fleet is nothing but all those buses, like bus stations and that's what you call by fleet. We're gonna have state transportation and then Ethem Urban and Blue Smart. For OEMs, we have Sigm, Delta, Mastech. Now, charging infrastructure, charge point is predominant, NTPC and Fortum. Charge point is, even in US, it's one of the biggest there. So they have their own charging station pretty much all across America. And like I'll learn a little bit more about India, but they have their own app that you can know the availability and the charge that they're gonna, it's gonna incur for every charge. So they are like leading there. Players for the charging infrastructure looks like all across the world right now. For the utilities, for the distribution companies, we're going to have Tata Power, Dani. So basically all the charging stations will be probably set by them and powered by them. So they are definitely very, very keen players, and government agencies are going to be there because they are going to be the regulators. And then how whatever the amendments are required, whatever right now. Actually, right now, government is really incentivizing this and driving everyone. You see charge point because he's incentivized. You see Tata Motors because all the cars are incentivized. You see all these buyers, people are buying because you're getting tax rebates. So government agencies are playing the key anchor of this whole effort to create this whole ecosystem. So we have to consider them as very, very important players as of now, especially in the beginning. Next slide, please. Okay, so let's look into our current market out. So factors driving EV transformation. So why are we doing all this? What's the push? Who's pushing? Just to give you a flavor, I want to say that by maybe 2030, EVs are expected to reach the price parity. So if you consider maybe a conventional car and EV, even if EV is slightly more expensive than a normal commercial car, EV on the go will be cheaper because, as you know, petrol is really expensive and maintenance is going to be expensive. So that's a value proposition for anyone who's buying a car. It's not only the upfront cost, it's also the cost which will incur over the life of the vehicle. The major actors investing in EVs, automobile companies, equipment supplier, government are investing. So I think we've already discussed that. Now, government mandates. EV growth will likely to be boosted by government support, such as consumer subsidies or infrastructure investments. Now, renewable integration. I think this is the key. When I showed you that EV is here for two centuries, like, okay, whatever, but why it's so much fat? I would, like, that's personal my opinion, that it's EV integration. Because now we see the benefit that we are producing electricity by a renewable source. And then how about I use that same electricity in an EV and get my, go from A place to B place. think about a situation 13 years back where you were burning fuel to generate that electricity. Most of the people use coal or natural gas, which is not renewable. And you convert it into electricity. And again, you use it in your car, then what's the point, right? I mean, it doesn't sound right. And now with this last decade of renewable integration, the whole purpose has changed. We see value, we see that it is coming from a renewable source and it's gonna be a net zero. Yeah. Definitely in the last 20 years, we know our planet is becoming more like hotter and hotter. According to UN, it's 1.5 degrees per year. And, you know, if we keep going by this rate in next 10 years, it'll not be possible to live, you know, without ACs and everything. So Earth is becoming hot and we have to start thinking about it. Okay. Next slide, please. Next. Okay, so now global EV market is growing rapidly despite the pandemic. So this is definitely very, very dear slide to me because last year we felt that most people didn't go to office or they were studying in the house. They had some financial problem. People lost their jobs. So it was a concern that whole this, you know, go green and all, like who would care, right? But to our surprise, whoever bought a car probably bought an EV because they understand that it's not only a vehicle, it is also, you know, helping in many other ways. So this is a very, very promising graph that if you see from 2000, like on the right side, if you see from 2010 to 2018 or 19, how many vehicles we had, and it's definitely surpassed in 2020. And we have to still see how the economy has come back in 2021 and how the sales would be. But the projection is definitely it's going to go one block up, which is a positive thing. Next. Okay, so this is just so that you know you get the flavor not only for your country, for our country and our state of Andhra or Telangana, it's the world. So whatever we are doing, pretty much the whole world is doing the same. Norway is definitely the leader for clean mobility. Denmark and Netherlands again a prominent leader. And if you see that India is right there. It has its electrified goals of 2030, which is matching the targets for Netherlands, which is known as the pioneer in this. So that's a great effort from India to compare. Just so as you know, Britain and Japan and China are also thinking the same way. They are trying to. Countries have announced mandates and they're going to switch to the clean mobility by 2035. And Canada is right there, means right now I live in Canada. So I know there's a huge push there by 2040 and Germany is right there 2050. For US, I don't see US anywhere, but for US, I know, especially in California, the mandate is 2030. Okay. But the federal and the state mandates can be different over there. So you might have a state mandate of Texas, different as California. So I pretty much one decade of my life, I lived in California. I know their mandates is 2030. They are retiring all their coal plants and Canada, because I live there, I know they don't have a single coal plant. If you go and look at their profile right now, they created a new nuclear, which is a greener nuclear power, which is almost their base load. And the remaining is solar and wind. They don't have that much solar. Like in India, we're really lucky to have so much solar. But in countries like Canada, which are like really snow covered, they don't have too much solar power generation. They might have so many panels, but they're not as effective as they are in our country, as India. So they're living with natural gas, and they're hoping as we have more EVs, they're going to create VPPs, the virtual power plants, and then somehow we'll be able to retire natural gas or probably hydrogen or something. But that's what I want to emphasize, that India is a country that we can really produce solar that can take our base load. It's not there in most of the other countries that you see on this board. So our EV challenge is more, I think, beneficial as compared to, let's say, Canada, who's generating electricity by natural gas, and we are generating our electricity by solar. So I feel our, you know, EV plan is more superior just by the demographics. Okay, so let's go next. Okay, so I'll try to wrap up fast. I get carried away and I keep speaking, so let's wrap up fast. This is definitely, I think we've spoken about this, where we said three-wheelers and two-wheelers, in our country, in India, the sales are really high, and that's what is our niche for our country. So we're going in the right direction. Buses are definitely government mandate, and we're going to see a huge improvement in next like 5 years for the buses and the passenger vehicles. Next. This is again the same thing, how the sales are going for two-wheelers and three-wheelers and four-wheelers and the buses. So you'll see everywhere it's a rise, and it's going in the right direction. And by 2030, we are hopeful that our mandates would be, would be accomplished. Next. Okay. So right on time, I would just conclude this session. Open for questions. This is a good slide. We can just take a quick read, but nothing is written here which I've not already spoken. So thank you so much. Off to you, Dhruv.
Thank you, Rekha. So that was kind of an overview of electric vehicles, and thank you for spending time with us. So we have a couple of questions which have been posted by people, and I will take them one by one. Okay, so the first question, maybe I think Pradeep sir, you would like to take the first one. So the question is, what are the potential challenges in meeting the goal for complete switch over to electric vehicles by 2040?
Okay, interesting questions, and many of the countries are talking about such possibility, whether at what point of time the entire country can be shifted to the electric vehicle. So I would say it's the question related to the establishment of ecosystem to have a complete transportation regime to be shifted on e-mobility. And that's required a massive task in terms of not only the replacing the existing fleet, which is oil and gas based, but also putting an infrastructure in place. And one of the concern which it's, I would say, the major challenge is putting the charging station, which is easy to access across, even with the smaller cities. The bigger city is always going to have the infrastructure first, but the last mile connectivity, the smaller area, the smaller type B or type C city. So having a charging infrastructure, it's going to be the critical challenge, and that's where the success is going to be lying on that. And the second one is going to be that right now the charging, the different type of charging is also, it's something which industry is working on. So the more and more the industry will grow, there will be a universal charging kind of setup will be established. So it's a type of charging and the charging station, the easy to access to the charging station. It's something going to be the, I would say, challenges, and at the same time, it's an opportunity for many of the student and entrepreneurship to really work on making this happen. So this is my take on the challenges for the next 20 years.
Yep, Thank you, sir. And so, Rekha, if you would like to add a different perspective from the North American market in terms of challenges to adoption in the electric vehicles.
Yeah, sure. I think one thing which is specific to my area is the range and its performance in extremely cold weather. Okay, so definitely the infrastructure is there. What I can see, you can roam around the whole America by electric car now. But this is like when there is extreme cold, the battery dies down really fast. So if the battery is about 300 miles, but if you are stuck in a snow, it'll just last maybe for 150 miles. So that's there. And that's why most of the people in snow, they don't want to go to electric because they said we'll be stuck somewhere. So that perspective has to change. And that's why I was saying that when you have the battery swaps, that might gain some confidence of the drivers that, you know, even if they're stuck, they have a battery line there. But other than that, like specifically like California, if you look into the numbers, it is almost there. But the other thing is petrol is really cheap and they have big cars, like big trucks, and they like it. So it's just perspective. So I won't say it'll go completely in the next 5 years, but government mandates are there that there will not be any car which will be sold. So it's like a kind of a forced thing. So in next 20 years, definitely whatever cars are there on the road, they will wear down and it'll come. The countries like Netherlands and all, they're extremely successful. They have the whole infrastructure. They have like everything is working on electric, all the vehicles over there. So it's based on people, different places. Like Canada is not that. California is great. Texas, no. Netherlands, awesome. So that's the flavor of the world.
Oh, right. Interesting. So we have one more question for you. So the question is, how do we say battery electric vehicles are zero emission vehicles? Because battery is charged by electricity, and electricity, of course, leads to some emission in some part of the city where the power is being produced.
That's a very good debate, and everyone debates on that. So kudos to you. I knew this question will come, but if you focus on the word zero emission, so we are not saying it's net zero yet, but it's definitely zero emission. I'm not emitting anything, like, you know, that black coal which used to come from that smoke pipe of our old buses, that is not happening. So that's the technical term of like technical definition of zero emission, that I'm not emitting anything. Okay, right now, if I am not 100% renewable on my grid, I agree with you. We are charging our cars from maybe natural gas. The example of Canada, they have around 12% natural gas in their grid. But once that's out in maybe next 10 years, then we call it net zero. Okay.
So, I think we have another question, which is also... Yes, sir.
Yes, I'm just adding to what Rekha said that, at the local level where that actually these transport are running, it's nearly to the zero emission. And that's where the transport emission comes to zero when it is electric. But yes, it will have an upside electricity generation and emissions, which is far, far lesser than what we are talking about in terms of some SOx and NOx also. But electricity will have a mostly the CO2 or not like SOx and NOx and SOx. So at the city level, at the municipal level, the emissions factor because of the transportation, it comes down drastically when it is going to be e-mobility. So I just thought to add.
Right. In fact, we are shifting the emissions from, you know, a city level to probably some isolated area which are not inhabited by the people, and that has its health benefits. Even though the emission levels are comparatively lower, but still, at least the area where the pollution is being created, assuming fossil fuels are being used for generation, that is a different area. So that is the point I understand. So thank you very much, Pradeep sir and Rekha, for spending time today for this session. It was an informative session. There are questions which are trickling in. There are questions which will keep trickling in. But in the interest of time, we will move forward. And the questions which will remain unanswered today, we will probably try and answer them later on via email. So so once again, Rekha, so thank you for joining us today for the session.
Thank you. I'll drop off. Bye-bye. Thank you, everyone, for joining.
So moving on, let's move on to the next session. Let's get a little bit more insight into the technology of an electric vehicle. I understand a lot of us are engineers and science students, and we would like to know a little bit more about vehicles than just some overview of how a vehicle works, which a lot of us are already familiar with. So for the third session, we have invited